Walkman era is a moment in history that is sun-faded and sepia-toned. Some see it as the good old days, back when things seemed more simple and familiar. Others look back and are grateful to have left behind the unfairness and chaos that ruled the state of the world. Though it was a different time, and both of these views may be true, how much have things actually changed? Matthew Weiner's masterpiece, Mad Men, explores the decade of the 1960s in a highly intelligent way. Using the myth of Don Draper as a lens through which to view the past, I have learned that nothing seems to be different at all. Mad Men is the story of a man called Don Draper, a charismatic genius who works as creative director at an advertising agency on Madison Avenue. Don lives a life of mystery and deceit, having affairs and hiding the truth of his past from his family and colleagues. He is an anti-hero throughout the run of the series, and though he may recognize the error of his ways, he never truly learns from it. The series starts at the beginning and ends at the close of the 1960s, not shying away from the true events from this time, often integrating them into the plot. Just a side note, I could talk about Mad Men forever and ever. There is so much to explore, so much to appreciate, and always some deeper meaning just waiting to be discovered. Its brilliance is unmatched. The writing, directing, mise-en-scène, acting, and even the soundtrack are all just incredible. I would highly recommend giving it a watch. Young people often view their present in a pessimistic way, but in a system that is not working, this can result in a form of active rebellion. In the 60s, youth disillusioned with the lives of their parents developed a counterculture movement. The hippies, as they were called, were primarily concerned with fighting injustice and calling for world peace, but a lot of them also experimented with drugs, spirituality, and alternative lifestyles. Some, though, were only embodying the persona of a hippie, much like those involved in today's counterculture are doing, but remained protected by privilege, class, or just the truth of who they are deep down. It's these kinds of inauthentic people that ensure the system stays the same, because they are the ones who overturn a rebellion by irreversibly poisoning its reputation. In Mad Men, the younger characters follow this pattern in a few different ways that demonstrate the nuances that represent the youth from this era. Don's daughter Sally acts out often throughout the show's run, starting when she is just 6 years old. She is influenced by her parents and peers as she grows up, but over time, she learns to adapt her own sense of self and takes responsibility for her younger brothers. Don's second wife, Megan, who is in her early 20s, is a very ambitious, independent woman, but she is also quite naive. Anna Draper's niece, Stephanie, turns out to be quite selfish despite her hippie lifestyle, and she benefits from the system in many ways, including taking advantage of Don's kindness. She is wise, but she doesn't seem to use it. Why is it, though, that as an outgrowth of one of the most prosperous decades in human history, did the youth revolt? Besides the civil rights movement, anti-war protests, second-wave feminism, and other poignant issues, the youth rejected this idea of prosperity so vehemently, only to become the most materialistic, capitalistic generation in Western history. It is the plight of the young to look towards the future with a bittersweet mix of hope and despair. Young people do not have enough information gathered from the past to formulate a pattern that outlines a plausible future. Older people look down upon the young for this, or write them off for speaking up and going against the grain, calling them selfish and disconnected from reality. Then, as we grow older, the role we play in society changes. Adults with families need stability, and in turn look away from the future and turn towards the past for a sense of relief and for answers. For some reason, the ego is uncomfortable lingering in the present. That is why, at the end of the day, we all become our parents, no matter how with it we may be. Sorry, but you're probably a poser. So, where are we now? Nowhere new. We are surrounded by influential media, created by a group of powerful entities. Identity rules politics. Technology is in constant uprise, which poses both a blessing and a curse, and the education system has not been updated to equip people to properly use these new tools. Nature and the man-made world are more disconnected than ever. We all hate each other. No one knows who they really are deep down. We are living in the era of the chair. Dirty clothes are piling up to the point where we are forced to sift through the stack to find something acceptably clean enough to wear.
It is time to do our laundry.
During the mid-century, the possibilities for technologies were endless. We envisioned convenience, cleanliness, community, and a symbiotic relationship between the artificial and organic worlds. The retrofuturism aesthetic and mid-century modern design style reflect these ideals. Retrofuturism is an art style that calls back to the feeling of anticipation for the future and is inspired by postwar optimism and the space age. These images evoke a sort of nostalgia for the past and fictional depiction of the future that could have been, but is not. Retrofuturism is tied to a dissatisfaction with the present, and suggests that an alternative path could be taken if we could only return to this time where these ideals were not yet forgotten. It is inspired by science fiction of the time, and envisions a world where technology appears symbiotic rather than overbearing to mankind, occurring in a utopian world that upholds its conservative values. It reminds us of the world that could have been, perhaps if we had crossed a different threshold. Though, if you live in this present time, you probably believe that deep down, this kind of world could never come to be, but it's comforting to imagine. Mid-century modern design is characterized by simplicity and integration with the natural world. Function is just as important as form. Not only are these architectural and interior designs beautiful, with clean lines and open concepts, but they emphasize meeting the needs of the average suburban family. Over time, design and culture has swayed in the direction of convenience, and we have lost sight of the organic. It is no coincidence that the mid-century modern aesthetic is coming back, but it feels hollow this time around. After 75 years, IKEA has launched a lineup of quote-unquote vintage mid-century modern furniture. We are still reaching for the same goals nearly a century later, and this is a reflection. People, like cars, have taken over nature and become nothing but consumers. The mid-century modern aesthetic is more than just a timeless form in this way, though. It is the blueprint of our culture. With the development of technologies that give us more time than we know what to do with, we may find that we feel our time is wasted if we do not use it towards productivity. No matter what, we do not feel fulfilled because what society tells us is important has not caught up to the rate at which we are able to adapt to our increasingly digital environment. If society is a complex, adaptive system with the purpose to provide for a healthy, thriving population, then what are the critical impediments to this failure to adapt? We must do the work. The work! It's not enough, not nearly enough, to make progress for progress's sake. We must educate why progress is necessary and how to shift the social psyche. Additionally, the anxiety and stress caused by this surplus of time, society's expectations, and the rate at which technology grows more complex leaves us with little room to breathe. The computer, the television, and even the copy machine are just a few of the inventions from the post-World War II era that have surpassed the evolution of their own inventors and users. Media of all types, beginning with the Mad Men era or advertising, have told us that we are what we consume, because what we consume is what we present to the world. This is a thin gruel for the soul. The result is a dopamine inflation epidemic that worsens as time goes by, and the idea that progress will never end. Dopamine inflation describes the phenomenon of how our society provides no shortage of sources through which to receive short bursts of pleasure. Behind each turn of the corner, we find another temptation or distraction from suffering without even having to try. In fact, we are encouraged to indulge in these activities by the media. On the smaller scale, peers who are attempting to appear satiated influence our own appetites. The access to truly nutritious sources of consumption feels inaccessible, as time is rationed, saved for some better future we see behind the one-way mirror. Everything feels temporary. Is it because things are developing so fast? Are we addicted to technology or to the idea of progress? I think that in the pursuit of progress, we feel an aching need to fill our time, just like when we see an ad and we want to fill that hole. Just as one example, television is one development that has a sort of character arc throughout the course of Mad Men's run. In the 50s, it became common for the single-family home to have a television set, and in the 60s, nearly every family had one to stay with the times. The TV partially raised children in the home.
Nobody cares that he's really, really, really gone!
Sally, go watch TV!
And expose them to the harsh parts of the world at a much earlier age than they would have been without it. Adults that grew up without TV became much more reliant on it as a babysitter, a source for the news, and a form of easily accessed entertainment. Over time, the reliance on TV compounded into reliance on screens in general, and this is not going away anytime soon. I would argue that TV, though a wonderful thing in many ways, was an invention that the human psyche was not prepared to include in daily life. Humans adapt to changing environments quite easily in general, but technology like the television has dramatically changed the way that we communicate and gather with one another. The stage of consciousness used to be limited to a much smaller scale, and with this technology, this scale has increased practically overnight. We are still recovering from, grappling with, and facing this change today. When SCDP gets a computer, those adapted are established in contrast to those who've been unable to cope with the advancement that this complicated technology has introduced. When people are unable to face their reality, they get paranoid. This is what happens to Michael Ginsberg, the manic genius copywriter that Peggy finds and Don hires. During his time in the advertising world, Ginsberg remains confident in his abilities and does not shy away from arrogance or the truth of who he is. Compared to Don, Ginsberg's allure is that he is brutally honest and unapologetically himself. In this way, it is no surprise that his comfort in his psyche crumbles to dust when SCDP gets their computer. Don and Ginsberg develop a rivalry, which adds to Ginsberg's psychological decay, but they are not competing in the same ways. When Ginsberg courageously confronts Don in the elevator for tossing out his idea in favor of his own, Don says,
"I don't think about you at all."
To Ginsberg, this is a blow. To Don, this is a moment of pure honesty. Ginsberg wants to be great and respected like Don, but all Don wants is to feel like the persona, Don, that he is constantly upholding to the world. It is a tragedy that Ginsberg's mental health takes such a toll as the outside world deals him such lousy hands time and time again in his life. His insanity is a product of his environment, both internal and external, brought upon by a form of progress that should have been gradual.
Nostalgia. It's delicate, but potent.
Greek, nostalgia literally means the pain from an old wound. It's a twinge in your heart, far more powerful than memory alone. This device isn't a spaceship. It's a time machine. It goes backwards and forwards. It takes us to a place where we ache to go again. It's not called the wheel. It's called the carousel. It lets us travel the way a child travels. Round and around, and back home again. To a place where we know we are loved.
It's delicate but potent. Don's pitch for Kodak in Mad Men's award-winning episode, The Wheel, reminds the audience what nostalgia is, the pain from an old wound. It hurts to think about times, people, and places we can no longer visit, but ache to go again. Not because they were better, but because we romanticize these things for their familiarity. Nostalgia is stored deep in our hearts, tied to our core memories, and as abstract as a dream. This scene from The Wheel is where we can see Don's love of seducing strangers thrive. This is something we learn the minute we meet Don in the first scene in the first episode. In his pitch for The Wheel, Don uses images of his own family, concealing the truth that it is falling apart, because the key to successful seduction is the illusion of intimacy. Good advertising, a good algorithm, knows you. It digs deep until it gets what it wants out of you. Another way in which this pitch works is that it is true to the universal human condition. Everyone knows how nostalgia feels. The consumer simply bridges the gap between their own life and the ad, filling in the gray area with their own perception of the world. Nostalgia itself is the gap between an idolized, usually past state and its absence, which create a shadow into the present. Nostalgia is an emotion like anger. It is secondary. It follows after initial sadness, happiness, fear. We access emotions in the conscious awake state, but nostalgia is more vivid, more dreamlike. Nostalgia is an ego-healing tool. We do not long for memories. We long for who we used to be, who we could have been, who we wish we could become someday. Even if we didn't fully exist in a certain time, place, or state, we daydream to manifest the ego, to settle into the narrative. This is why nostalgia is so bittersweet. It is the cognitive dissonance of existence simultaneously in the narrative of reality and the participation in the vibrations of the universe. There is, however, one form of nostalgia that we must consider: the wound of the unsatisfied ego. In Buddhism, this is called the dukkha, or the pain of existence. When we see an ad for something that displays a piece of who we wish to be, that triggers the nostalgia for the perceived version of oneself that we long to uphold. The work of advertising dooms the world into slavery by consumerism. No matter how much money is spent, nothing will scratch the itch. Like a bug infects its victim with venom, so does the ethos of an ad trying to sell you the idea that a product will make you feel, think, or be a certain way. Now, things have grown even more dire, and our portable phones are able to listen to us and watch us all day long, sending targeted ads for things that already make us itch. Additionally, and I hate to even mention this word, influencers, use their platform to create these aching holes we desperately try to fill, to literally reach a different aesthetic, so that we may commodify ourselves next. As Dawn sits in the sanitized boardroom, surrounded by sanitized people, talking about stimulating imaginations, he feels the essence of his beloved industry boiled down to a horrific science. Dawn finds himself realizing that he could have been, maybe should have been, the very man they are categorizing as the target market. At McCann, Dawn is just one of the indistinguishable creative directors. He is nameless, faceless, and trapped inside a corporation without a soul. A boxed lunch with his name on it sits next to a laminated, sterile set of facts that mark it to a simplified caricature robbed of any inner life. When he sees the plane flying above, Dawn chooses that route instead, leaving his ubiquitous can of Coke untouched. He flies away. The conference room used to be the one place he had control over who he wanted to be, expressing himself in fleeting moments of connective brilliance disguised as an ad pitch. That place is now gone. Dawn has become a living relic of a time abruptly and unceremoniously past. This is the moment where Dawn wakes up, where the dissonance between his inner and outer selves grows unbearable, and he chooses a different path. At least for a while. Nostalgia in its emotional form often leaves those who felt confident in their persona left in the dust, aching to go back to a time or place where they were secure in their identity. As I said before, nostalgia is a secondary emotion that follows feelings such as sadness and anxiety. There are two characters in Mad Men who embody this condition. Roger Sterling feels nostalgic for his days in World War II in some way, not because of the war, but because of the way that being a part of something bigger than himself made him feel. This psychological phenomenon is quite common, especially for men who want to feel suited to their inherent masculinity. Roger is proud to have fought for his country alongside friends and fellow Americans because it made him feel like a man. As an individual working at the advertising agency with his name on the door, not through hard work but nepotism though, he feels the need to prove his manhood through womanizing and entertaining himself constantly. He seeks happiness because he cannot find it in the present, and therefore clings to his past self. His nostalgia is a follow-up of sadness and grief for his lost youth, and even though he has everything a successful American could dream of, he feels a bit like a gigolo in his own life.
At a certain age, they lose that. What? A glow of pure youth?
Similarly, Betty aches to go back to the 50s, where she felt like she knew life's rules and had the best tools to play the game. Her mother, though she was emotionally abusive and passed her own insecurities onto Betty, is someone that she admires greatly in retrospect. She attempts to teach Sally that beauty takes a woman far.
You don't kiss boys, boys kiss you.
Betty's looks got her into modeling, which is how she met Dawn and was granted the fairy tale life of a wife in the 1950s. However, in the 60s, as a mother, living in a big house in a suburb far from the bustling city life, waiting for her cheating husband to come home, she longs for things to go back to the way they used to be. Dawn and Peggy are masters of using nostalgia as a tactic, both in their ads and in their own lives.
You don't like what is being said, change the conversation.
Peggy learns this from Dawn, and Dawn learns this from his childhood trauma. The two of them are initially square pegs in round holes, but Dawn sees potential in Peggy, and he actually rescues her from facing one change that would take this away from her by telling her to
get out of here and move forward. This never happened. It will shock you how much it never happened.
She does, but she differs from Dawn in that it is harder for her to acclimate to her trauma. As she grows in her work, though, Peggy learns to use her empathetic nature to her advantage by using it both as a way to create great ads and as a way to shift the way people perceive her.
I don't think anyone wants to be one of 100 colors in a box.
She does not want to be sexualized. She does not want God's will to force her into being a mother. She wants to be Peggy Olson, first woman creative director. She wants to stand out. Dawn starts out as a used car salesman, then a fur coat salesman, which is how he meets Roger. It is clear that he is initially very optimistic, but anxious, and he has not hidden his brushstrokes quite yet, as Betty's mother would say. Dawn learns that the best way to seduce a stranger is through the illusion of intimacy, the illusion of vulnerability. He utilizes this several times throughout the show. My favorite moment of this is when he writes the "Why I'm Quitting Smoking" article, which in its controversy is one of the most brilliant demonstrations of his ability to simultaneously deceive and charm others. Dawn knows the ins and outs of advertising and how it is impossible to escape. He indulges in cigarettes just as much as the next consumer, despite the health concerns, despite knowing that ads merely create an itch to be filled by dopamine. He is a victim, and he knows it, so he uses it. This form of nostalgia is less emotional than it is rooted in the ego, which means that it perpetuates in selfish motives and patterns common for these two main characters. In the end, the only person who can truly understand how Dawn feels is Peggy, who he calls when he faces the death of his idealized persona. Not only does Peggy feel afraid for her mentor and friend, but this moment reminds her of the fear that she feels for the death of her own conceptualized identity. The baby boom post-war and corresponding suburban sprawl doomed future generations to be further westernized or solely concerned for their individual needs. In turn, the sense of community that is included in small-town life, and even in city life in some ways, was lost. People became more reliant on cars at this time, which only fit one family, typically. Even though suburbs have communal establishments like churches, country clubs, restaurants, and other examples of the third place, outside of work in the home, these fixtures have become more and more irrelevant and out of touch to the way suburban people live. Their time is occupied by work or school, and then they go straight home. The family unit on its own provides at least some sense of social stability, but it is difficult for just one or two people to raise any number of children without struggling in some way. As they say, it takes a village, right? The concept of the perfect suburban middle-class life has shaped our culture in such a way that further divides the classes of our society. Suburban sprawl is a root cause of environmental damage, further segregation, and car reliance. The criteria is quite unrealistic. Do you have the perfect 2.5 kids? Do you have a good car? Do you have a white picket fence? Is your grass too long? It's a fine line to walk, the line of the middle class. It's designed to feel ever so slightly out of reach, but impossible to overcome. In healthy communities, everyone must play a role, which may be attached to a certain identity, but this is not as required as we may think. Rich, poor, a certain race or sexuality or gender, these things may define us in small ways, but they are not correlated to who we really are deep down. We are not adjectives, we are nouns. The persona is a product of the threshold crossing. It is a social fiction created by the ego to mirror the self-conscious reflection of inner dialogue to which we attach I. It is the ego's attempt to be externally perceived the way I finds itself or wishes to find itself. In a culture where the ego is persistently damaged, the ego ignores the truth of the identity of the I and chases the persona. A person is, to their core, who they authentically choose to be simply because they are a unique, indestructible part of the universe. This includes the circumstances of their identity and their own path. Betty feels like she is trapped in a birdcage that is suburban life. She feels so anxious that she experiences shakiness in her hands, which symbolizes the way that she feels a lack of control over her life, and she kills her neighbor's pigeons to symbolize the way she wishes to kill her own suffering. Dawn even calls her Birdie. The standards of the 2.5 lifestyle, though not only limited to women, expect roles to be performed not based on the institution of community, but on the expectation of perception.
What is wrong with you?
You do not have to be a woman to be a woman. But the rules of 2.5 do not abide by this. You simply must be a woman to be a woman. This goes back to Betty's obsession with appearance. When she finds out about Dawn's secrets, she can no longer accept her role and immediately finds a new man with which to participate in the narrative of life. However, with Henry Francis, Betty finds herself feeling too comfortable and lets down the guard of her persona, gaining weight and even taking up political opinions while at an event for her husband's campaign. One of the more unfortunately relatable characters in Mad Men is Pete Campbell.
Not great, Bob!
He is unlikable simply because he tries too hard to be like Dawn, seeking approval from him constantly.
Let's take it a little slower. I don't want to wake up pregnant.
However, Pete has something that Dawn does not. Privilege. Despite this, though, Pete feels unhappy in his role because he does not feel like a real man. He has a happy marriage and even finally has a child after years of trying, yet he cheats on his wife and gets Peggy pregnant the day before his wedding. He has a great position at work and even a chance at moving up, yet he develops rivalries with Ken Cosgrove and Lane Price, which lead to him objectifying his wife to get a story published just because Ken got one published, and fistfighting Lane simply because he was the one who said something stupid. Pete can't even fix a sink the way that Dawn can. Pete is a lot like most of us because he tries to fool everyone but continues to fail. It is also symbolic that Pete is one of the only characters who doesn't smoke cigarettes because even though he is a part of the world of his workplace, he's not a part of it as fully as the rest. Peggy broke boundaries in her gender by rising up to a man's position in the workplace. With her great talent and self-confidence, she is similar to her co-worker Joan in many ways. Joan is also a polar opposite, using her femininity to her advantage under the male gaze, but even she falls into an unconventional role as a single parent and entrepreneur. The two of them never end up being friends, but from day one, they gradually gain more and more respect for one another. They are two characters who venture beyond the barriers of what is expected of them as women. The middle class includes prerequisites, and even though he falls short on the inside in terms of his upbringing, Dawn convinces others of the legitimacy of his role. He appears mysterious and alluring to both other characters in the show and the audience, but inside, he battles anxiety and narcissism, which traps him in an existence that can never satisfy him. He keeps his facade going until the moment where he finally exposes himself publicly to a group whose opinions matter if he wants to carry on with his place in the agency and his life.
I was an orphan. I grew up in Pennsylvania in a whorehouse.
Dawn admits that he is lying to himself and his peers at this meeting because he has not done the work to heal from his trauma, and he continues to self-sabotage because of it. As we ignore the crucial roles that people play in communities and solely focus on the personas that others uphold, we are inclined to ignore the healing process and either excessively or minimally focus on the network of media, politics, and social issues in order to feel like we fit in a certain category. We isolate our true selves from the public, our peers, and even our own families as we are individualized by society. And we fill our time with work, stress, and cheap dopamine. This is how the characters in Mad Men live. Most ignore what is happening in the world, sitting above everything near the top of a skyscraper. Many carry the weight of their own problems wherever they go, and soothe themselves daily with vices of their choosing and an addictive dedication to their work. Now that we have taken the time to pause and reflect on how this mid-century marks and represents a cultural threshold through which we have passed into a certain timeline we would have never anticipated, an opportunity arises. We must seize this chance to find the inevitable, inescapable loophole that any conceptualized thing contains. The process of reflection allows us to reconcile with any turning points and to frame the past as a piece of time with a more layered dimension than the linear model we use to study history. How can we reframe the turning point paradigm and shift to the perspective of a non-linear threshold? They say that history repeats itself. I would argue that history, like all forms of nature, is a cycle, and events are impacted by the culture the way that water is infected by pollutants. If a culture never changes, events may rhyme with one another, and we may fall deeper into imbalance. This is why it is so important to mark the cultural shift in the mid-century from more community-driven, balanced lifestyles to identity-focused, individualism-centric ones. We live in the future on the linear timeline, but in the non-linear realm of time and space, we are still in the same place, and will have and will continue to be there until another shift and a different pattern emerges. The opening titles of Mad Men offer a glimpse into Don's own mind, and the minds of those facing similar problems with their identities, consumerism, and the American dream. The falling man, who appears to be Don himself, stands in his office as it falls apart, but he does not move. He falls from the skyscraper, passing advertisement-like designs of the female body, alcoholic beverages, and brief glances into the ideals of marriage and family that Americans uphold. He seems to fall forever until landing upon a bench where Don's outline casually sprawls his arm across the back with a cigarette clasped between his fingers. This entire sequence, we do not see Don's face, which mirrors his mysterious persona and his unwillingness to show the world the truth of who he is. Sitting on the bench is the Don we know, but the truth is, the real character of Don is falling constantly from great heights, faced with his vices and forced to grapple with others' expectations. In the psychology of dreams, falling represents anxiety, helplessness, and a loss of control. It is Don's creation of his persona that makes him feel this way. The Mad Men era was one that ached for the future, including in one's own identity. Progress, innovation, shoot for the literal stars. Though all of this can feel wonderful and empowering, a utopian future like this is only imaginary.
Utopia. The Greeks had two meanings for it. Utopos, meaning the good place, and utopos, meaning the place that cannot be.
We have been living across the threshold, and each iteration of the pattern becomes a new past. This is neither good nor bad, it just is. This pattern will continue until we realize that when we look backwards, we are also looking forward. The familiarity for those who lived through history since the mid-century is like a soothing aloe for the bug bites of need that the cultural ecosystem cultivates. And this helps to form impossible imaginings of a non-existent future. We can never make it to the future because it does not exist. Neither does that version of yourself you believe could exist. Until Don wakes up to this reality, he will keep falling forever. The last scene of Mad Men is the greatest ending of a show that has ever been created, respectively. Argue with the wall. This is because it is ambiguous, but also perfectly clear. One interpretation is that Don's smile finds him in a place where he is mentally at peace with who he is, and he comes up with the greatest vision for an ad yet, and this almost makes him laugh. He has integrated Don with Dick after all. Another is that he exploits his meditative state and his experience at the retreat in this stroke of genius. Both of these could be true, but they are only implied. The greatness of Don Draper is the way he concocts a solution for something in the moment. As he meditates, he smiles because even after hitting rock bottom, he is still convinced that he is, can be, will be, Don Draper. He had to run away and abandon everything to find himself, found himself relating to Leonard's struggle with his own identity, said goodbye to Betty and to Peggy, and after all of that, he fell right back into the pattern. Or perhaps he knew that he could. We don't know where Don goes next, and for all we do know, he's still sitting cross-legged at Big Sur, overlooking his beloved ocean, the only place where his feeling of insignificance can evaporate. The zebra is not black with white stripes, nor white with black stripes. Just like Don embodies the good and bad of man, so does the universe vibrate with duality. Our values create our outcomes, but they do not have to be static. What makes a value unable to shift is the refusal to adjust the way we make our choices. This is why history repeats itself up until a point where a collective group decides to change a societal value, such as the civil rights movement. These shifts take time, but they are more than possible. Unless we reflect and learn from our past choices, we will never change. So if all of us are Dick Whitman trying to craft a Don Draper persona, then that is the problem. Authenticity. The ability to be raw and unedited, unapologetically who we are. This is the critical theme to take away from the show. We could live a million ideal lifetimes, but we'd still end up right back where we started in the end. The reconciliation of the self has been fractured in the modern age. And until we remember that we are who we're meant to be, and the only way we can change the outcome of our lives is through our choices, then nothing is ever going to change. Drawing inspiration from the past can be the perfect place to start rebuilding the fragments of the cultural pattern. While we know that life cannot be lived backwards, we must also face the truth that life is not lived forwards. All we can do is live here, live now. Only then can we cross again. Only then can we be truly satisfied.
I'd like to buy the world a home and furnish it with love. Grow apple trees and honeybees and snow white turtle doves. I'd like to teach the world to sing.
Sing with me.
Goodbye.